So back to our lovely panel. Hello, Pierre, Henriette, Jesper. I'd like to take a chat around some of the things that Anne touched on, and we'll have some time to answer your questions too, to everybody who's listening out there. I want to dive straight into this. Anne talks about leaders risk-taking, and risk, I mentioned it on the video as well, risk seems really scary to me. Maybe I'm just risk-averse, but risk seems the last thing you want to do when the boat is rocking. So, do you consider yourself risk-takers? Maybe Henriette, you can
I start. Certainly do. Maybe a little too much sometimes.
I think
what we've seen this year, as Anne alluded to also, is that we systematically underestimate the risk of not doing, right? So the risk of waiting might actually be higher than the risk of jumping, right? So I think one of the challenges that we see if we go to boards and executive team discussions is that there is often a tendency to saying we need more information. Let's make the decision next quarter. And that behavioral pattern that is basically not creating any value for anybody, but it is actually at the heart of risk averseness, which is there in some teams, that has shifted over 2020 because we've now seen that we have to make the decision now. Mm. And many of the decisions that we've seen and had to make over 2020 would not have become more certain had we waited or had we done more analysis. So I think I see teams, I don't know what your experiences are, but I see teams and individuals leaning more forward, jumping more to decision making than has happened before. Maybe one challenge on that is, of course, when you are in a crisis mode, the number of more fundamental decisions that you have to make increases a lot, right? And that, of course, gives you more experience. So maybe that's why, I don't know.
And Pierre, I saw you nodding during that as well. Do you agree?
Yeah, I think you put it very clear. So I don't have that much to add to that. I think that's the mechanism that has happened. And then it comes back to some of the more core values again about having a trust environment that benefit when you are in such a situation where you need to do that. That will help even further. So if you had that from the beginning. So these are good... basic values of having good values in your leadership. And then, as I mentioned, also the vulnerability that you dare to show that you don't know the answers, which is part of also... increases others to daring to jump out of the box and have a crazy idea and then test it. Mm-hmm. If you yourself is also acting really like, I have no clue what to do now. Any good ideas? that you put yourself again out of the role as being the leader or the manager. It's a collective thing. We are on the same ground here.
Mm.
And no one has the answer. No one has the answer. Mm. So let's collectively find the answer. And then, yes. So it's to unleash that again. So yes.
And that's the best that has happened in 2020, right? Everybody was like... clueless, right? Nobody had seen that anything like that coming, and it just sobers you up, right?
Yeah.
To know that you never the largest thing that can happen you can never predict, right?
No.
So actually, knowing that you have everything on the list, for now we know we don't have everything on the list. There will always be stuff happening.
So
right?
It's much better to probably be robust when it happens because it will happen. So I think that's something that. But no, I completely agree. I think maybe. A twist to that is also sometimes that leaders are expected to make decisions all the time, and non-decision is not seen as leadership. Sometimes, and I agree by the way that sometimes you can postpone too long because you're waiting for some data that will not show up. Right? COVID is a great example where you basically you're seeing a very very small part of this the full distribution, and what we've just seen in the last 3 weeks. I think. 3 or 4 weeks, more people have died within the last 4 weeks than the rest of the period combined. So we're just seeing extreme exponential growth. And so basically what we're seeing in the beginning is nothing. So we cannot base our decisions on that. We have to base it on some principles. And there I agree with you also, Pia, that let's just be clear on what those principles are then, and let's just be transparent about it. Mm-hmm. I think Anna also mentioned it, that's so key. I think that's so key. Just be transparent about the values, the fundamental principles you use, and then you can disagree or agree, but then at least you know where it comes from. I think also Snipper, the CEO of us here in Denmark, mentioned it, that part about, maybe I think it was last year, he said, listen, I definitely don't have all the answers. I don't. So don't, you know, don't expect me to have them. I rely on you guys as well. So there's no one particular person to look towards, especially in crisis situations.
I love this vulnerability. It's not something I've heard leaders talk about very much at all. So I think from the other side then, we talked earlier about millennials coming into the workforce and already part of the workforce. What advice, or maybe advice is not the right word, but what can you share for them as well? Because they're not in your position yet, but hopefully there will be one day. What does, not just risk, but like, what's their, what could help their path?
I think actually the points that Anne made on you know, being humble and curious were really, really, you know, well put. And I think it's I think one of the challenges, you know, Anne works in the environment of social media. I think one of the worries I have if I look at the next generation is that some are extremely good at connecting and being aware of how can I actually help you, Pia, rather than focus on myself. But some actually, you know, continue down the very narcissistic path. And without being too gloomy in my communication, I actually do believe that the ones who will lose out are the ones who actually, you know, continue down the path of narcissism. Because you can't, if you want to be a leader in the future in all different kinds of companies, you need to be focused on the other, be the customer, the consumer, the competitor, you know, the world, you know, the society. You need to be focused on something else than yourself. The world is larger, and some of them are natural on that and some are not, and it's actually an interesting divide for me. I'm very curious at how that will play out.
Very interesting. Yeah. Very interesting.
Completely agree, and I'll add then also, and talked about engineering serendipity. So basically, the random events that happen. I think I would argue that random events play a much bigger part in our life than many are probably willing to like or agree on. And so a lot of it is also about knowing. When you're willing to take, so to say, the risk when the offer or the chance happens, and basically just survive until you get lucky, right? it's part of it. I believe that at least. So
the principle of luck.
The principle of luck. It's extremely powerful, and it's about being there when it happens. And it plays such a big. And I think for many of us also, when we look back, so many completely random events, are kind of like the cause for where we are today. Mm-hmm. That we had no idea. So, you know, a good exercise also for young people, and especially, you know, upcoming, is to say, where 5 years ago, where would I believe that I would be 5 years from now, and how close are you in with that prediction? Chances are you'll be very far away from it.
So, good point.
Well, I'd love to go to some questions. I've got lots more questions, but there's lots of people sending in their questions, so I think we should give them a chance to ask as well. I'm going to go from the top. And in flat organisations, most of the voices are being included, and trust and transparency are essential. What would your recommendations be for organisations who are more hierarchical and where trust and transparency are lacking? And yes, I can see you nodding.
I think, you know, to me, the advice would be, and I don't know where you're calling from, but it would be get with the program. Because I honestly think it's going to be very hard in the future to run a classical hierarchical organization. I think that, the organizations that will thrive the most are the ones who are outside in, who are focused on the consumers, the customers, and going back into the organization. So I think, of course, there has to be some kind of, you know, formal hierarchy. But if you look at the conversation going on, it has to be, you know, conversation and not orders from the top. I think that if you look at least if you look at Denmark and look at the companies who do well, you are from Lego, Jesper, Ørsted you mentioned before. If you look at the leadership style and the organization of those companies, you know, if you go to the bottom of the decision-making process, it's not classical hierarchical, I would argue.
No, yes, we're talking smiling. About millenniums. I think it's even further important to emphasize, because these constraints about the hierarchy is not even in their mindset. So that would really challenge that generation as well. They would be super challenged.
Probably wouldn't even go for the job.
No,
right?
Probably not.
I mean, maybe just one comment on that. If you look at some of the sectors who have at least the employer brand of being more hierarchical, for example, the financial sector, you will see right now that the number of people who are looking for jobs in that sector is going down, right? Mm-hmm. So and that's of course a sign that you want to work in an organization where you're involved in decision making, right? And where there's a purpose.
Yeah, purpose.
Lovely. I have a second question that's come in. I have a lot of questions, actually. Don't be afraid. They're all nice. Do you think the new ways of working can be a force for good to break up toxic work cultures and lead to a new, more empathetic mode of leadership? I mean, we've touched on empathy a lot and the vulnerability and everything like that, but what would be your answer be to that?
I would say yes, and I think our conversation has confirmed that. If we say we have this way of working before and now this, then I think the beauty of combining, or we will find, I think companies will find their own way in between. That is the new usual. Then, so then you take somehow, if you're smart, you take the good part of everything and then you combine it. So I think that must be the aim, and I trust that will happen, because no one wants to go back to bad things. So that's what we learn. I mean, when you have learned something great and you know a new skill, or in this case in a new way of working, why would you go back? So I think it's collect. I mean, everyone will just have this, we need to do something else. So it will not be like black and white, it will be something gray, and the gray will be different from company to company, values to values. But of course it will change, in a way where everyone feels that this is good.
It feels like a duh moment in a way. Of course I'm not going to go back.
That's actually, from a workplace perspective, I think that's extremely interesting. And also, of course, from a leadership perspective, because I think there is consensus that it's been such a great step that we're, that because you can get, bits and pieces, the good bits and pieces from, so to say, both worlds, more work-life balance, ideally for the individual, right? The company can actually also use its space better and make sure that the offices are there for that socialization. But why wasn't this so obvious 2 years ago? I mean, do we really need a crisis to? So why was nobody doing this? Because the value proposition, I've been sitting with it, and I've presented it to our executive leadership team. It's so clear and obvious. So why didn't we do it? It was also clear and obvious 2 years ago, but we weren't forced to do it. So I think that's also coming back to what Anne was saying about sometimes it is that for me is a bit mind blowing, and also maybe still also explains a bit about the risk taking of companies. There are some things are so ingrained in us still, going to the office every day as a default mode. Nobody questioned that really. Some did, but not to the extent where we actually made full company blown decision, changes based on it. So for me at least,
and
that's pretty interesting.
So it's interesting that actually this pandemic has went so far, or has taken so long, that actually can change habits. Mm-hmm. Normally we go into a new mode and then easily go back, because it was not long enough. But I hope and I trust that this time actually it has created so much. The system has understood the new, so we don't go immediately back.
It's true.
I think it's so true. And I think just maybe one, I think the philosophically in all executive teams, you will have the executives who trust your employees, and you'll have the executives who don't trust the employees, right? So empathy is a little bit complicated. I guess it's two ways of being empathic, right? One is give everybody freedom because we trust them. The other one is you can't trust them, so we need to take care of and do the calendar for people, right? But now we've actually proven that efficiency goes up or stays at a good level, even if we work remotely, right? It's actually a minority of colleagues who find it hard to organize their own work in this working from home. So that actually just, it's wonderful because, you know, the good guys win here, right? It's, the proof is actually that we actually do our work, even if we have to work from our, you know, living rooms or our bedrooms, right? Which we knew in global companies, we knew that before because we had actually had that experience, but we were uncertain about it, right? And I think it just shows we can do it now, right?
Proof is in the pudding,
yeah.
And I'm impressed with how fast it happened, how fast we all adapted as well. I think that's a takeaway I took from the early days of it. It's just like, wow, okay, we're running with this. This is the way we go. And, it worked. Some bits of it worked.
But isn't it that everything that is meaningful, you adapt immediately? Mm. And I think coming back, we have known this unconsciously and it has been there, but we haven't dared formally to take some of these decisions that could make this happen. As you said, we knew it already, right? So I think if it's meaningful, then that's what we are drawn towards. When things are meaningful, then we do it because it makes sense.
It's really interesting because it touches on a question that I jotted down here for myself as well about what leaders are good, and talked about leaders being good at recognizing something in themselves at moments of pivot. And I think I'd like to ask same question of you. What experience do you have with that? And it sounds like we're touching on it there a little bit already, but is there anything else from your experience, those moments you've had to pivot? Just to put you all on the spot, of course.
Yeah.
Live on camera.
Yeah, I think there's, you only know what you know when you need to know it, right? It's like, it is the moment where you are most under pressure that you actually suddenly flourish, and we see that over and over again. So I think, and it goes for individuals, it goes for organizations, it goes for teams. I think the most important, one of the fun conversations I had when I, at the time I was in Lego for a short while, was actually discussing with the executive team, because everything had gone really well for a long time when I joined. So talking to them about why have things gone so well? Which is, of course, the most, you know, the most rare analysis we ever do, right? Because we're so preoccupied with what goes wrong and why did it not work.
So
I'm just thinking about, Phil, now that you talk about pivoting moments, it's about acting and then it's about finding out what it is that we do, because that's actually at least as important, right? Because then you can repeat it, right? But I'm actually more, the reason why I'm a little, you know, I'm probably more collectively focused than Anne was in the talk, because I'm very focused on when does the collective pivot, the moment where, you know, a collective being the board and the executive team, when they can suddenly talk about stuff in a different way. Mm-hmm. And that's not an individual process, and you can't sort of, it's a sort of a popcorn moment. It's a, you know, suddenly the conversation shifts. And that's actually, from an organizational point of view, to me, more important than the individual. You know,
yeah, interesting perspective. Yes, and it works on both levels. Yeah, I can see that. Yeah,
and probably companies with strong values have a benefit here. I think, and here we represent some, but it might not be in all companies who has a good value set that is really part of. So you also have that in your toolbox. So when a crisis is there, okay, for instance, togetherness or whatever, as we, one of those we have. I mean, so I think it, we can also see differences in how companies has come to this.
It's a very good point. You have mission, value, and purpose.
Yeah, exactly.
All there, you know, and everybody buys into them and believes in them. I guess that much must help, especially when it comes to leaders, being able to kind of get everybody on the same path.
Plus, I think there's also deep wisdom, especially in failings. So, I mean, I would much rather read a book about someone's failures throughout life than someone's successes, because it's, you know, a lot of that is also, when you look at it backwards, everything seems to be just maths, and that was like, so you explain it sort of say afterwards, yeah, of course that was, you know, it couldn't have happened otherwise, you know, of course I would have been, you know, I would have been successful given this and that, but I think failures are much more generalizable, and what Anne is also saying in his speech about, or you know, in an interview about Eric and Jeff, again, what makes them great leaders? I mean, you can find thousands of others who have the exact same traits. So what, you know, but what it's probably there, you know, a lot of in their experiences and their failures and how they've, and a lot of luck has been.
Serendipity,
well,
right? Yeah.
Serendipity as well. But and I think sometimes it's also about, we tend to, for good reasons, by the way, and maybe it's again back to the focus on the individual, the great leader. I think sometimes also about thinking, you know, what you call via negativa. So what makes you not a bad leader? You know, what is needed for you to not be a bad leader? Because we want to get rid of bad leaders. We want to have good leaders, and then it's okay, we have some great leaders. But I think maybe if we can just manage that, there'll be a huge step along the way of actually of having a collective good leadership.
And that's actually why I think that your companies, when you are so value-based, why you do significantly better, because you seem to be better at weaving out the individuals who are so self-centered that the only thing that matters is my own results. Exactly. And then, you know, you just ruin stuff around you. Exactly. So I think and I think that's actually the best thing about very, very value-driven organizations, that you seem to be better at weaving out those individuals so that the collective,
yes,
of leaders, mm-hmm,
yes,
become better, right? It's, yeah, the, and it's very impressive. Because
I think it's so true, and I actually what we're also seeing, at least at LEGO, at least that would be my observation, that like Henriette, I've also worked with some of the senior leaders at LEGO, and they seem to be more, so to say, influenced by the culture and the values than vice versa. Mm-hmm. Even though they're very strong leaders with, you know, great characteristics and all that. Which is interesting. I think some companies very much become one individual, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Which could be toxic, can it not? Sorry, Henry.
Yeah, and maybe just one on that, yeah, note, one interesting fact. In 19, I believe, and also maybe also 20, was the first year that the number of CEOs who have left their job due to value clash or some kind of, you know, outrageous behavior, so to speak, was higher than, you know, other reasons. So it's just to say, we it seems as if the whole community around boards and executive teams and headhunters and, that you know, professional advisors are sort of, you know, increasing the expectations on the values and the behaviors and the sort of the link between what you say and what you do. In the executive suite, which I think again is great.
Yeah.
It's about time. Yeah.
I agree.
That's super. Okay, we're going to take another question. I have experienced that a flatter organization can lack focus and vision, jeopardizing the strategy as more voices and opinions are shared. How can this be avoided? Yes, but maybe because you were giving your keynote on the workspace and the workplace earlier, what do you say to that?
Well, yeah. To be honest, it's I don't know. I mean, Pia, you had this great. You talked about earlier about giving direction, and then after giving
yes,
direction, give goals, and then leave the room, right?
Yeah.
So I think there's something in there for that. I think it's important to say that if you know all opinions matter, and all we should look for all opinions. But there's still some inputs in the end that are better than others, and we should strive to take them in and build from that, right? So it's not about. So I think it's important to be open towards input, getting everybody's input in. That's also the flat organization. That's also what, you know, the office hours. Let's get everybody in, to make sure that we, because it's such a, you know, the complex world, of course, with so many feedback loops, and it's impossible. For one person to figure it all out. So let's get the inputs in, but also let's make sure that we filter out and are clear about that and build from that. So I think there's a lot of communication in that, and there's of course also leadership in making sure that that process happens. So I think so it actually requires leadership to be bold also to say, yeah, but some ideas we're going to build from, some directions are better than others. But we've listened to everybody, so but I don't know if you.
I can recognize what is being asked about here. That there is, of course, more mess, you could argue, in flat organizations.
Mm.
But it's important to say that just because you don't hear the different voices, it's not the same as saying as they are not there. So I would argue, in a very hierarchical organization, you've got so much mess going on. People wasting live, because they're discussing what the executive team have decided, right? So I would argue the open conversation in an organization needs to be taken anyway, right? But of course you hear it more in a flat organization. You could argue the most efficient organization is the organization where the shared story about why we're here, who are we here for, mm-hmm. why are we here, mm-hmm. what the hell are we doing, and why are we better than anybody else. The organizations that share that story the most, they're the organizations that are more that are most resonant, right? And where there's less, you could say, inefficiency. But in order for that to happen, you need to discuss stuff, right? You can't agree before you've disagreed.
I'm interested in the process of when you've collected in these opinions from a flat structure, what goes, like leaders like yourself, what goes through your mind and how to make a decision on all those probably varying viewpoints? Is there certain approaches or tools you take to that, or?
Again, if the vision is clear and you have some goals, I mean, very simple things,
yeah.
then you benchmark towards that. I mean, so that gives you, that could be a very traditional way, but it's,
Completely agree, Pia. I think that's where strategy comes into play.
Yeah.
Basically, strategy is, at least for me, it's a tool for decision making. It's something we refer back to whenever a decision is being made, right? As a very low key example from one of the responsibilities I have in my team is designing offices and all that, right? So if we one of our ambitions as a team have fun and playful as an ambition when we do offices, then every time you were to choose between, let's say, two different kinds of curtains, you would pick the fun and colorful one, never the gray or the white or whatever. So it's a tool for decision making, right? So something to relate back to. So I think that's where strategy comes into play, and that's also where the transparency then becomes clear, because the strategy is something that that you ideally also have built together in some way, at least, right? So, yeah.
Thank you. Well, we're closing up time. I'm going to try and squeeze a couple of questions in just before we go. Does the panel, yourselves, reckon that leaders will work to keep the positives of the work from home model as the return to office is implemented? But it says positives here that everyone in the online meetings could participate and be heard in open discussions, reducing the hierarchical feel. So we're going to keep the positives of the work from home model. What do you think?
Hopefully.
Yeah.
Do you want to?
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Seems to introduce some of that work-life balance a little bit more.
It's great to be able to sleep 8 hours every night and swim in the ocean every morning and never fly with planes. I mean, it's great, right? And I hear just last week I was talking to two different board members saying they've never been more fit in their life, right? Yeah. Because they've actually been able to sleep and work out more than they've done before. Of course, we'll need to hold on to it. I think one of the challenges is that in the executive teams over the next couple of months, there will be this discussion. You know, how will we come back? And I'm a little bit worried that that there will be this anxiety around, ooh, is this chaotic? Can we actually control it? And they will, mm-hmm. there will be this leap back to controlling in the old way. And I was like, there was no control in the old way. Just because you sit at your desk 8 hours is not, you know, mm-hmm. the same as saying that you're productive, just like you said, Jesper. It's input measurement, it's not output measurement. Mm-hmm. So I really hope that we will hold on to the good stuff. Yeah. But let's see.
Completely agree. I think we're at least in Atlego, we're at least one of the things that I'm sure we'll keep is the online part, where people will try to be, you know, if it's a four-person meeting, and one is online, I think the three others will also try to come online, because we now know the big difference between the power difference between being the only one online and the rest sitting together. Until we get some good technology, I think the minority rule applies there, where the others will adapt to that person being online. So I hope we'll at some point, I know some technology has been being built as we speak, but where you can actually have people together. Because of course it would be nice if you're three, you know, persons in the office. It would be nice because we, I guess most of us would rather be physically in the same room than actually off online.
So it requires some new rules.
Yeah, for sure.
Play rules or
guidelines or whatever.
Guidelines for how to work, because otherwise it becomes imbalanced suddenly if you don't do So that's the new thing on the table.
I was going to say, that's the thing we have to develop now, isn't it? And kind of co-create.
It's probably not called rules either, but it's some sticks, so some frames for to make it work for everyone.
Or some sub-values.
New ways of working or something.
This has to be in place, otherwise it's not working. Otherwise it would be super...
Which is quite pertinent for the title of this this whole universe as well, designing the new usual in that sense. We've got to find what this new usual is.